Actually, it was, before me, it was Boog. So I wanted to share a little bit of, a little message of how I kind of came about with Carlos, and we've developed a great friendship over the last, I don't know, 7, 8, 9 years. I'd say, I guess about 8, 9 years ago, Boog came up to me and said, you know, there's this guy who's doing stuff down in Tijuana, and he is the real deal. And when Boog tells you somebody's the real deal, you know, I take a lot for what Boog used to say. And, you know, he came across a lot of people in a lot of different ministries. And he said, there's this guy who is this ex-Marine, and he just feels called to do the work of the Lord. And it's taken him from Costa Rica to San Diego to the military academy to over into Tijuana and start La Roca. And he went on to say, Eric, I can't really tell you what he's doing, but we're going to do a scout trip down there to really see it, and you're going. And I was like, oh, okay, but I'm going. A little nudge from Boog, it's like, I'm in. So what we found was just, we brought our kids. I mean, I think Zeke and Keaton came down the first one. My boys, Brock and Max, came down. And we really got to see what Carlos and his team and his beautiful wife, Rosie, are doing down there. And you see things on TV, but when you're there, and just seeing the love that's shared and just changing people's lives from the lowest of the low, the neediest people that have just been left to fend for themselves. And it's just really kind of grabbed my heart and kind of touched my heart. So that was just something I wanted to be around. It's very, it was very real. It was very, and it's just, you know, 60 some odd miles south of us. You know, it's like a trip to Pasadena, but go south. And so we started doing that, I'd say, with the church. I don't know if anybody gone on, has anybody gone? Everybody raised hand? Awesome. Yeah, that's right. So yeah, there's several of us in here have gone. And we started off doing day trips. We'd meet at Pico Plaza at like 6 a.m. and load up about 4 or 5 vans and or whatever cars and head down south. And really, the message from Boog was, look, it's more about what we can do for Carlos and team. This isn't about feel good for yourself. I get that. Nothing's wrong with building homes and hammering nails and doing all that stuff. It's just, where do you need us? Where do you want us, Carlos? And I'll never forget Boog's message. And I didn't understand it at first. Like, you know, we just need to kind of step in and just let them rest because they work so hard. We just need to, whatever we can do just to take off some load from their shoulders, whether that's hugging the kids in the orphanage, which we'll get into in a show here. I don't want to get ahead of myself, but what can we do as a church? What can we do as a group just to go down and help with, whether it's helping staff, whether whatever Carlos and team needs us, let's do. And it's not about us like, hey, this is what we're going to bring. It's like, what do you want us to do? And that really kind of resonated with me. And it's been a good few years. A lot of that changed when COVID came. So we had a lot of momentum. We had a lot of activity with the church. And we were going down, you know, fairly regularly. And then COVID came and it just kind of stopped. And so it's been tugging on my heart and I've still kept in touch with Carlos and just to see how we can kind of get that back going. I feel like we should as a church. If that's on your heart, there's opportunities. So why not bring maybe a potential opportunity to participate if you'd like. Other than that, I mean, I think I'll let, I can come up here and just tell you how great Carlos is and he is and Rosie and how wonderful they are and the changes that they've made within the lives of people down there. And a lot of it's centered around drugs, prostitution, and just people left with nothing. And when you go down and you see the testimonies from people who were left to die or a woman who was just knew nothing other than to be just a prostitute and for them to give, for La Roca to provide an outlet. And it's just so real. It's not like, hey, we're only helping you if you believe in Jesus. That's not it at all. And I think Carlos will share that with you. It's not that at all. It's just so pure and genuine, and it just drives people to Christ through just or just sort of beautiful, organic, natural way. And I think we're lucky Boog introduced us, and we still become friends today. So I think we'll just kind of go to the video, and then Carlos will come up and share his message. Thank you.
La Roca was established in the city of Tijuana in 1998, reaching women, men, and children in the streets. People without hope, struggling with addictions and homelessness. The purpose of La Roca is to bring the gospel of hope and restoration through our Lord Jesus Christ, providing accommodation, rehabilitation, family integration, education, and protection for all who are in need, reaching out and equipping workers to be sent to take the gospel to the nations. Currently, La Roca Ministries is working in the following areas. Oaxaca. La Roca Ministries has a cafe that serves the malnourished indigenous children of the Sierra Mije, providing food for 62 children 3 times a week. Our children's club brings a message of hope for their lives that they can carry to their parents, reaching entire families for Christ. Sonora. La Roca Ministries has planted churches in a number of communities in Sonora, bringing the gospel to men, women, children, and adolescents, and providing fresh food daily for low-income or poor elderly people, bringing the gospel to various communities and to all ages. El Rancho. Discipleship Ranch is a completely free, one-year program where a man can find his true identity in Christ. With the capacity to accommodate 40 individuals, this program is for men battling addictions and alcoholism, providing them with work skills, offering psychological and spiritual guidance for their personal restoration, and equipping them to be sent as ambassadors of Christ, sharing the good news of salvation in other ministries and enabling their reintegration to society. Albergue. Our homeless shelter has the capacity to receive 150 men each day. Our doors are open to give refuge to deported men and men from all parts of the world, offering food, showers, beds, and sharing the Word of God with the goal of reintegrating them into society and reconnecting them with their families. El Basurero. La Roca Ministries has an outreach located inside Tijuana's municipal garbage dump, offering support to workers, men, women, and children, providing daily meals, drinking water, as well as water for personal use, showers, clean clothes, and supporting children with food and transportation to school. This program serves as the community church with cell groups and Bible studies, providing emotional, physical, and spiritual support. The Orphanage. The mission of La Roca Ministries is to love each child who enters our home, to provide what every child should have: food, a bed, clothing, education, making their lives as normal as possible, and sowing the seed of the Word of God, teaching them to trust in His promises. Academia. The Academy is available to single mothers and to women who have a desire to leave prostitution. We provide free English, nursing, and cooking classes with the intention of equipping these women with not only new life skills and opportunities to elevate their current situation, but more importantly, to bring spiritual insight and restoration.
Good morning. My name is Miguel Mendez Pimentel. I am 49 years old, deported. I found myself here in TJ alone, with nobody. I found myself trapped in the world of drugs and alcohol. Came here to La Roca. They offered me if I wanted to rehabilitate myself. I went to the ranch to the rehabilitation program. I finished the program. Now over there, I had an encounter with my Lord Jesus Christ, and now I found myself serving here at La Roca.
Hola, mi nombre es Santiago. Tengo 27 años. Soy servidor de tiempo completo aquí en La Roca. Yo llegué a La Roca a la edad de 11 años a través de alcances que se hacían donde yo vivía. Ahora servimos de tiempo completo en la casa hogar, también en la alabanza. Y Dios ha hecho grandes cosas y ha restaurado a mi familia hasta el día de ahora.
Hola, mi nombre es Silvia, tengo 26 años y llegué a la edad de 13 años a La Roca en un alcance de Celebrando a Jesús. Ingresé a la casa hogar por problemas familiares, abusos, una familia disfuncional. Y cuando entregué mi vida realmente a Jesucristo, fue a la edad de 19 años y comencé a servir en la casa hogar de tiempo completo.
Hola, buenas tardes. Mi nombre es Federico Vega Vega. Tengo 48 años. Tengo 18 años dentro del ministerio. Llegué cuando tenía 30 años. Antes de llegar al ministerio, mi vida estaba en drogadicción. Vivía en el basurero, con una vida vacía y desordenada. Cuando llego aquí al ministerio, mi vida cambió totalmente, gracias a Dios.
Dios los bendiga, mi nombre es María Gómez, tengo 53 años, tenemos dos hijos y estoy bien agradecida con Dios por todo lo que me ha dado. Me ha dado dos ministerios, uno es en la casa hogar como directora y también me dio el ministerio de la zona norte, donde voy y comparto la palabra de Dios con las mujeres y se les hace la invitación para la academia.
La Roca Ministry is constantly growing. We are very clear on the mission God has called us to: reach, restore, equip, and send. Be part of this call. Be part of what God is doing. Be part of La Roca Ministries.
Good morning to everybody. Honored to be here before you and be invited guests to come and address the congregation. It's such an honor and such a blessing to be before you. Greetings from everybody and from Tijuana to you, all of you, especially my wife. She can't be here. We have a group at this present time that just arrived last night that's going to be with us for a week. I'm going to not share too much. The video and the testimony is already given. Demonstrate what we do. I'm just here to testify God's goodness, God's faithfulness, how God sustains and blesses the work of those that put their trust in Him. Amen. I'd like to open up scripture to Matthew chapter 8. And it's going to be a short, sweet message regarding the power and the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ, reminding us who's with us and reminding us what we've been called to. We must always remember we've been saved from something to something. We're not just saved to just wait for His arrival. We're here and have been saved to serve a purpose, to fulfill the calling which He has set upon His church. And I believe we can't take this lightly. I don't know if you all have seen yourselves as an ambassador for Jesus Christ, but basically that's what each one of you, including myself, are. We are ambassadors of God's kingdom, ambassadors of the King Himself. Yes? And we must walk according to His calling. We walk according to knowing who called us and who's by our side, who's with us. And that's why I chose these passages to remind us that just as the leopard, just as the centurion, knew who Jesus was, that he had all power and all authority, and also how easy it is to forget who's in the boat with us. That's why I believe Scripture tells us, keep your eyes on Jesus all the time. Because we're surrounded with so many distractions. We're surrounded with so many situations that if you take your eyes off Jesus, you'll lose focus. You'll lose focus for the purpose why we're the church of Christ. You'll lose focus why he called us, why he restored us, why he blessed us, why he called us. So if you join me, Matthew chapter 8, we're going to read Matthew 8 verses 5 through 15. And let's read. Now when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him pleading with him, meaning begging him, saying, Lord, my servant is lying at home, paralyzed, dreadfully tormented. And Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him. And the centurion answered and said, Lord, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak the word, and my servant will be healed. For I am a man also under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this one, go, and he goes, and to another one, come, and he comes. And Jesus heard him, and he marveled, surprised, and said to those that were around him and followed him, surely I say to you, I have not found such great faith, not even in Israel. And I say to you that many will come from the east and the west and will sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the sons of the kingdom will be cast down to outer darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And then Jesus said to the centurion, go your way, and as you have believed, let it be done. And his servant was healed that same hour. When Jesus had come into Peter's house, he saw his wife's mother lying sick with a fever. And Jesus touched her, and the fever left her. And she arose and served them. Let us pray. Father God, we come before you, Father, first of all, grateful and thankful for who you are, Father, for the calling which you set before us, for healing our hearts, Father, for liberating us from that slavery that we were in darkness, to a holy calling with a purpose. Lord, let us never forget the purpose in which you have saved us and have called us to, that we may be faithfully servants of you and faithfully ambassadors of your kingdom and yourself. That we may speak boldly, Father, of that which you've done and the one that we follow. That we may not be ashamed of the one that healed us and rescued us and purchased us with his blood. Lord, thank you. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. Amen. So again, I want us all to understand, first of all, just like the leopard and the centurion came to believe that all power and all authority are of Jesus. That nothing gets moved without him. Nothing gets moved without his approval. That all things were created for him and in him. Yes? We must have this understanding, and it's more of an, we must believe with all our heart so that we can walk as the church of Christ here on earth until he comes back for us. We cannot treat this as a casual thing. But we must understand it as that is our purpose in our life now. But I don't know if you see yourselves as an ambassador, but you are. I know you're walking in the series now that you are the salt and the light of the world. That means being an ambassador, a representative of his kingdom here, speaking, proclaiming the truth, which have set us free. That's what Scripture says. You shall know the truth, and indeed you will be free. Not a temporary freedom, but everlasting freedom. So this centurion came to Jesus, begging Jesus about his servant being home, paralyzed, torment. We have no idea why he's being tormented, but he comes pleading with Jesus. And Jesus said to him, good, let's go. I'll go home. I'll go to your home and I'll heal him. But the response of the centurion kind of like surprises me, and it should surprise us as we read it. We will expect that he will be excited. Oh, great, Jesus. Oh, good. Y'all follow me. My servant is waiting for us. But no, he said something on the contrary. He says, no. I think that's the first time somebody tells Jesus no in that regard. He says, but the purpose, the reason he said no is quite something to take note of. He says, no, Jesus, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof. But just say the word, and I know it will be done. So here, the centurion is acknowledging two things. First of all, something we all should acknowledge. We're not worthy of his calling. Yes? I know that might catch you as a shock. A lot of us think, oh, no, I'd be a great asset to God's kingdom. You know, I got lots to offer. But when you put it into the perspective of a biblical truth, we need a Savior. And we're not worthy. We're receiving something we're not worthy of. We're blasphemers. We're liars. We're thieves. And so much more. But the servant said, I'm not worthy. But he said, just say the word. He knew who Jesus was. And this is a Roman officer, a Gentile. He knew Jesus. He knew all he had to say was just say the word and it will be done. He knew he needed to go to his house. But also maybe as being a Roman officer, he knew the traditions of the Jewish culture. He knew that if Jesus was to enter his home, he will become unclean. That could be a consideration. But I would say the main one is what he said. I am not worthy. But we should walk forward. It's hard for us. I felt unworthy when God put the calling in my life. I felt like Moses saying, God, have you forgotten my past? How can I be a spokesperson of your truth? How can I be a spokesperson of your love? How can I be a spokesperson that represents your kingdom? I'm not worthy of your calling. And we all should feel that. But by God's grace and God's mercy, he finds favor for some reason in us. And he calls me out of darkness and into his marvelous light to follow him and to send me to places I never even considered or imagined. A lot of people have asked me, Carlos, when did you think of becoming a pastor? I never thought of becoming a pastor. That was because that's the first thing in my mind. It was not even in my radar. It was nowhere. It was nowhere. I'm doing things that it was never an inclination, a consideration. It was nothing. And especially when God called me out to the streets of Tijuana to work with gangbangers and drug addicts and women in prostitution and kids' gangs and so forth. I'm not a drug addict. I'm not an ex-gang member, a cartel, et cetera, et cetera. But God called me into this territory. And I said, God, I have nothing in common. But then, of course, I found out I have more in common with them than I ever thought. A sinner is a sinner. And we all take different routes in that sin. Disguise it in different ways. But we're all sinners that need a Savior. Regardless of what walk of life you might find yourself in. We're all guilty. And that's why we feel unworthy. Because he calls us now to his marvelous light. To be an ambassador of God's kingdom. Father, something to meditate on, something to think about. But the assertion goes on to say, for I am a man under authority. That's acknowledging that he's acknowledging that Jesus has no authority. He says, I am a man under authority. And if I say to him, my sword, go, he goes. And as I say, come, he comes. I say, do, he does. We can also include there, he says, I'm also, if my superior tells me go, I go. I don't hesitate. I don't say, can I be there? I'm going to be a little late. I'm busy. I got things to do. I'll see you maybe tomorrow. No, I am also under authority. And if I'm sermon to go, I go. His calling becomes priority in our lives. His calling becomes more important than anything in this life on this earth. There's nothing more important than God's calling. Because there's a greater purpose that comes with the calling. A greater purpose that comes with his calling. And it says that when Jesus heard this Roman officer, he says he was marveled. But that was the first time Jesus gets surprised. Of course, we know he knows all things. But he was surprised in the response of this Roman officer. And he told all the people around him, I've not seen such great faith, not even in Israel. But what did he believe? He believed that Jesus Christ had all authority, had all power. It's just like the leper in Romans chapter 8, verse 1. There was this leper, and if you know lepers are set aside, you must stay excluded, right? From society, from the community. And if you were to go out for some reason and you come close to people, you must say, unclean, unclean. Then people don't approach me. I'm dirty. I'm filled with disease. But somehow the word about Jesus got to him. And he decided, I'm going to go find Jesus because I know he can heal me. So he left that place reserved for leopards, putting his life in danger. Because if you were a leper found within the community, that's being stoning. But he says, I know the one that can heal me. So when he found Jesus, he found and he started worshiping. He says, Jesus, I know you can heal me. There's no doubt in my mind that you have all power, all authority to heal me if you just are willing. And Jesus said with those marvelous words, I'm willing. And he touched him. And he was healed. But something they both have in common. They knew that Jesus had all power and had all authority. Why am I emphasizing this? Because if we're going to be ambassadors of Christ, if we're ambassadors of his kingdom, that means we go to the world with security, with confidence of who is sending us, who is behind us, who's in front of us, who's to our sides. It's like Jesus Christ calls, go. Don't worry, I got your back. I got you covered. And I was willing to go, not because, I'm brave. But I knew who was with me. And I knew the one that called me. Yes? Very few agreed. I'm one that likes response. I mean, we must agree. We must understand. We must come all to that conclusion. Jesus, I know you're with me, even though I don't feel worthy. But Lord, I know you have all power, all authority. And what you say, it gets done. Your word does not come back void. Your word accomplishes what it was meant to accomplish. Your word will prosper what it means to be prospered. So it's not based on my skills, not based on your skills. I don't care if you're a CEO, whatever the case might be. It's not based on your intellect. It's not based on your skills. It's based on Jesus' power and authority in his word. And if he's called you to do something, it's our job to respond in obedience to our Lord and our commander in chief. and go and not come up with excuses. We are to walk and we are to serve just like Peter's mother-in-law. Jesus found her home sick with a fever. He touched her. He healed her. And immediately she got up and served them. That's our Christian life. Service. Service to our Lord Jesus Christ. Service to those around us. Service to those who are in need. Service in the sense of proclaiming and declaring God's truth. If you have been transformed, and if you've been delivered by God's truth, then what more than anything else should you be sharing with the world and those around you? The same truth that made us free. The same truth that rescued us. The same truth that we've been purchased by the blood of Jesus. If you've been saved, purchased, rescued. I know we don't share much of those words, but we actually have been rescued. We have actually been rescued. So then we come to, we have no excuse. What excuse can you give me? Will you be like the one that came to Jesus? Jesus, I will follow you wherever you want, but first let me go bury my father. That's some profound words there. And what was Jesus' response? Let the dead bury their dead. You follow me. Now. Jesus not being uncompassionate. We already know he's compassionate. So what is the meaning of this interaction between Jesus and this one that said that he needs to bury his father first? I say that God's heavenly calling is more important than anything here on earth. That comes first. More than anything else, Jesus' calling comes first. His father was going to be buried. Maybe not by him, but his father would have gotten a decent burial. But the most important thing, Jesus says, I'm calling you. You follow me. Just like Jesus said, well, God has called Abraham, right? Pagan country, pagan family. Abraham, I'm taking you out of this country into a new country. You follow me. Without knowing the answers, without knowing the questions, without knowing nothing, he left and followed him. But one thing we must be careful of. These same disciples that walked with Jesus, followed Jesus, heard Jesus' teachings, saw the miracle of the leopard. They said they crossed to the other side and they got into the boat. And said, out of nowhere, a storm came. Apparently it was a big storm, according to them. And they panicked. But Jesus was sound asleep on the side. And they panicked. And they said, wake the master. Let him know that we're perishing. And we need him to save us. And what was Jesus' response? He rebuked them. Saying, you, a little faith. Someone like saying, didn't you see the miracles I've done before you? Didn't you see me turning water into wine? Didn't you see me eliminate leprosy? Didn't you see me? Didn't you know that I have all power and all authority? You should be like the leopard. You should be like the centurion that knew that all I have to do is say the word and it will be done. So he rebuked the disciples. And then he rebuked the wind. And he said the word. And the word and the wind stopped. And the waves stopped. I believe like crystal clear. Not even one ripple, right? We throw a rock and not even little. And the disciples were astonished. I said, who could this be? That even the winds, the sea, the elements of nature obey him. we must come to that conclusion that the one that has called us has all power, has all authority. And if he's called you to do something, and if you walk in obedience, I can promise you one thing. It will prosper. It will accomplish what was accomplished to do. Because it's his calling. It's his work. And I say this as a testimony. I never imagined I'd be in Tijuana. I never imagined we'd be out of Tijuana and Sonora, Oaxaca, and Chiapas. I never imagined none of this, but I just followed Jesus. I said, Jesus, you have the final word. I'm yours. And I would say, well, I no longer belong to myself. I belong to you. Well, you know what? I'm bust your bubble, but you never belonged to yourself in the first place. You didn't. But we surrender ourselves to him. And we walk following him. Don't get distracted, church. Let us not be distracted. These 28 years, yes, I can vouch. Yeah, there's many things that have come against us. There's been many distractions. There's been many things that can make us discourage us. I've seen all types of examples, excuses, attacks of the enemy to discourage me, to bring me down, to throw the towel in. But I said no, because I know the one that called me. I know the one I serve. And hopefully all of us here can say, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Yes? As for me and my house, I know who we serve. And I will not be distracted from that calling and from whom I serve. I will not be distracted from whom the one I represent. And I will walk with confidence, knowing that the one that's called me has all power, has all authority to be the light and the salt of the world. Yes? May this message be clear. May there be no doubt. Don't let Satan bring doubt into your lives, into your minds, into your hearts. Because when there's doubt, there's the danger of fear. And when fear comes in, it paralyzes you from moving forward to that which God has called you. But if you keep your eyes on Jesus and remember who called you and who's with you, then there should be no fear. I remember when a lot of people used to ask me when I started going to the drug-infested territories, into the crack houses and so forth. And they knew I was not Mexican. They knew, and my Spanish has improved quite a bit after 28 years of being in Mexico. They knew I was from the U.S. But a lot of people were asking, Carlos, weren't you feared to go in there by yourselves? And I would respond two different ways. First, I was willing to die for a flag one time. I was willing to die for a nation one time. Why should I be fearful of dying now for my Lord Jesus Christ? Yes? And second, I know who walks with me. And he can protect me from all harm if that's his desire. But if he was to allow something to come upon me, I knew in my heart that it was going to be for a greater purpose. A reason that maybe I could not understand, but I knew that all things that happen, if he permits, is for his glory. And I walked with that. And I walked with confidence. So after 28 years, going 29 years, I stand before you testifying, God is good. God is faithful. Keep your trust on Jesus. Keep your eyes on Jesus. And whatever he has called you to, it will prosper and it will grow. There's no doubt about that because it's his calling, not yours. It's his work, not yours. It's his. We're just blessed to participate We're just blessed for him to call us and participate in his work. And there's no greater blessing, there's no greater purpose, there's no greater life than that. And a lot of people tell me, well, Christian life is kind of boring. Have you tried walking in the calling? And if you start walking in the calling, let me tell you, you're going, it's not boring at all. You'll be challenged every single day when you start walking in obedience to him. So I'll leave you with this short, sweet, and hopefully powerful message that allows us to examine and consider God's calling and his word. As the word says, iron sharpens iron. And we're here to sharpen each other to do the work of our Lord Jesus Christ. And of the worship team, please. And let us pray. I'll stand up, please. Father God, we come before you, Father, first of all, grateful and thankful for this day. We're thankful for this first day of the week that we come before you to give you our very best, to give you our first moments of this new week, which you have granted us. Lord, thank you, Lord, for your word that sharpens us, your word that challenges us, your word, Father, that takes us to new heights. Lord, thank you, Father, for your salvation, for rescuing us, for purchasing us in your blood, that we no longer belong to ourselves, but we belong to you, you who have purchased us and have called us. Lord, let us walk with confidence. Let us walk, Lord, according to your will. No longer our will, but your will be done in our lives here on earth, here on heaven, or here on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, we surrender all. And let us never forget who called us and who walks by our side. In Jesus' precious name, amen.